Many years ago, Pastor Morrison recommended a book. It's by a man named Derek Prime, and it's called On Being a Pastor. How many pastors know that book, On Being a Pastor? And on page 50, there's a quote that I pulled out of it. It says, "To establish goals brings benefits and dangers. The principal benefit is that we know at what we should be aiming, and thus we avoid dissipating our energies on secondary matters. The main danger is that we may become so goal-orientated that we set unrealistic targets, which then become a rod for our backs and discourage rather than spur us on. But this danger is no reason for not establishing proper goals. It is simply a snare to avoid. Our purpose is to determine the goals God wants us to have rather than those of our own imagining. A substantial amount of current writing on this subject owes more to business practices than to biblical precepts. It is imperative that we take our direction from scriptures, from scripture." And so that's from Derek Prime and Alistair Begg on Being a Pastor on page 50. Have you ever beat yourself up about anything, about a failure that you might have had? How many people have beat themselves up? It's okay. Don't be ashamed. But you beat Pastor Stan. That's always the way to go. Yeah, take it out on everybody else. I mean, because we all have our list of failures, right? I have a list. You know, in one way, I could say the outdoor bookstore was a failure. I could say the Bible school is a failure. I could say all our evangelism is a failure. I could say that the postcards that I once spent $2,500 sending out before Easter to 5,000 people in our area around our church, and one person came from the 5,000 postcards, I could say that that was a failure. I could say that our follow-up is a failure. I could say that our visitation is a failure. And in many ways, each and every one of those are failures, but each and every one of those also has redemption and was successful in many ways. The outdoor bookstore we did for 2 years, unfortunately, I did most of it with one other guy, and that's when I was just trying to do everything myself. And it was awesome. At the same time, it was exhausting, and I knew after the second year I could no longer spend my entire Saturdays in 95-degree heat outdoors, you know, selling books and ministering to people, but it was fun. But it did spur on evangelism from people in the church, which was great, but nobody ever took it over. The Bible school usually starts out with about 15 people, and by about mid-semester, I've gotten all the resignations, and then there's three or four people that are still there and that might make it until the end. The postcards I mentioned, visitation just doesn't happen when it should, as much as it should. And so there's always reasons to beat yourself up. But it doesn't mean that we shouldn't have those goals or those expectations or those visions or those ideas for ministry from the Lord. What it means is that we should expand our ministry base, meaning we should use our own people, whether they're brand new or whether they're not brand new. I don't find that it's a good idea to wait a year for someone to be in your church before they get involved in ministry. I mean, I literally went soul winning 1 week after I got saved, which was stupid. You know, nobody, why would you do that? You'll never come back to your church. But actually, you know, we had a guy, Shay Watson, some of you know him, he's got like tattoos everywhere, and great, amazing guy. And, you know, he just brought this incredible smile to our church. He's always smiling, and he's a big, tall guy, good-looking guy, and he's always like right there and loving the church. And, you know, 2 or 3 months after he joined, we invited him to join the team singing, and he did. And he did a great job, and he enjoyed being part of something. He needed to be part of something because things were going on in his life that we weren't aware of, and he needed to be part of something. And then he began to go to Bible college, and then he came up here to convention, and then he began to take classes from here, and he took my classes, and now he's part of our evangelism team, and just an amazing guy. But, you know, had we not allowed him to participate early on, I don't know if he would have actually grown. And yes, it was a risk, but we do take risks in ministry. We have to take risks in ministry. How much time did you have in China, Laura, when you met somebody, right? Not that much time always, but you gave them responsibility maybe. I don't know how that worked. I don't know how it works in Korea, but in different places. Maybe you have time with people, maybe you don't have time with people. But how long do you wait? It's a question. It's being led by the Holy Spirit. But I say that we don't give people too much responsibility, but it's okay to give them a little responsibility. It's okay to have them feel part of it and to have them see God move in their life. But trying to do it all is not going to work for you. If you're a team leader, trying to do it all is not going to work at all. If you have a team, you have to use your team. If you have a team, you have to trust your team. If you have a team from Baltimore, or if you have a team from your church that are mature people, you have to let them stand or fall. You have to give them responsibility. As limited or extensive as you might want it to be, you have to do it. Otherwise, your church won't grow, your team won't, you'll be forever doing everything all by yourself. And there are great limits to what you can do. It's one of the things that I learned from a few years ago. I haven't been perfected in it. I still want to do everything. And I still feel like I could collect the offering, sing the offering song, song lead, set the place up, preach, make the coffee, and all, except for doing Sunday school. I hate doing Sunday school. Except for Sunday school. That's why I have a wife. I would do everything, you know. But remember, Rita, when I used to lead worship with you? Until the day that we couldn't do that one song here in your presence. Do you remember? We were doing Here in Your Presence.
Here in Your Presence.
A very complicated, actually, song. It's not easy. That's not easy. Mindy, who is now Mindy Stein, was playing piano. Me and Rita and I think Catherine were on the stage. I was song leading because I'm amazing. And it was so bad. And the band was so bad. Nobody had the timing. In the middle of the song, I just walked off the stage like this. And I went and sat down. And I'll never remember Hanata, who is now Hanata Fritchett. She said, "He just walked off the stage." And she had just gotten saved just before that, I remember. And it was just so funny. And then Mindy just kept playing and singing, you know, like dutifully, you know. I'm done. And so I think that was the last time I led songs. I just like... I don't need to do this. I really don't need it. And my ego certainly didn't need to do it. So, and Rita learned how to sing it somewhere in there, you know. And so, you know, I know. Can only do what you can do. And it does. It takes time. We mentioned earlier, it takes time to develop leaders. But we can't be afraid to use people, even if we're not sure they're ready. You know, there's a risk involved. Even if we're not sure that they're gifted, we don't know what their gift is all the time. They don't know what their gift is. We know they have a gift, but we don't necessarily know what it is. And even if we're not sure they can do it, I wasn't sure that I could do it. You weren't sure that you could do it, but we did it, and we're doing it. And so I remember when we started the Welcome Ministry, and to me, this was a huge thing in our ministry. I spoke about it at the pastor's conference last fall. But the welcome thing was like, so I tried. I don't know if you remember this, Rita. There was a man in our church, and I had sent my niece, who had just gotten saved, to a church in San Francisco, and she quickly, because she's very bubbly, she became part of the First Impressions team, which is a great name, right? First impressions are very important, especially in a church setting. And I thought, we need a First Impressions team. And I talked about it to our group, and we had a guy in our church that said, "I'll do this." And he was like, "This is the perfect guy." He said he would do it, and he never did. And I just kept waiting, you know, for him to do. And we had people picked out, and he literally never did it. And I just said, "Okay, we're not going to have a First Impressions team, and we'll just stick some brochure or bulletins at the door. But when God eventually did it, when we could do it, we took our tent last year, about a year and a half ago, we took our outdoor bookstore tent, which was just sitting in our shed, and I made the same size signs as we had, and they just said, welcome, you know, it's our welcome center. You say welcome center, I think, yeah. Well, and then we developed better guest packets, and we got a team together, but people from our church that were very excited, and then we built it up to the hilt, and we kept talking about it, and we launched to the welcome center. You know, it was right before, 2 weeks before our first Friends Sunday, though we had had many Friends Sundays, but now they were all Friendship Sundays. Now we're rebranding. So we had Friends Sunday. We got these awesome mugs, and everything was so cool, and I thought, you know, I know the people in my church, and if we give out mugs to the new people, they're all going to say, well, I've been coming to this church for 5 years, and nobody ever gave me a mug, you know? And so, you're supposed to laugh at that. That was like a perfect impression. You know how you think that way, because you all have the flesh, you know? I try not to give mugs to people from Baltimore, though, because I figure they're already in my church. Anyway, mugs, amazing mugs. They have our logo on them. And I wanted everybody to buy into it. So the first day that we launched the Welcome Center, I wanted them to experience it. So I had everybody in the church in the middle of service line up at the Welcome Center to receive their free mug. And they were so excited. It was amazing. And there were these new people there. They're like visiting from South Carolina, their daughter, and just saw the signs that we put out. And they were happy too. Never saw them again. But they got their mugs. And, you know, but, you know, getting people to participate was amazing, because then we said, hey, we need people to be greeters in our Welcome Center. And we have never been shy of greeters. And now they set it up. They do all that. It's like, and of course, knowing me, if any of you ever worked with me, I tend to make things as complicated and as possible. You know, I mean, we still do it very fast. We're just very good at what we do. We started off with a, you know, walking everything, had a little closet. Now, then we had a van full of stuff. Now we have a trailer and a van full of stuff. And we have to set it up every week. It's amazing. Every week. It's awesome. Go to our Facebook page, Greater Grace Christian Fellowship. You'll see a picture of Pastor Mati preaching, and you'll see all these curtains. It's called pipe. Is it pipe and drape? Pipe and drape? So I started with two sections, 20 feet of backdrop to kind of make a stage to, you know, focus everybody on the stage. Because we moved the church because the church was getting bigger, and we used to meet in the building like sideways like this, but then we moved it this way. But that was all windows, and it washed everything out. You know, you looked at it, and you're like looking at me preach, but it's bright coming behind it. So we got these black 8-foot curtains, 10 feet wide, and I thought, this is awesome. Well, then I thought 2 is good, but wouldn't 3 be better? And so I bought more. And then I thought 3 is good, but wouldn't 5 be better? And then I thought, well, wouldn't it be good if we kind of came this way on this side and this way and had, and then, you know, and people are like, oh my God, we have to set this up every week, you know? So easy. So easy. I could do it. I could do it all myself, except for the soundboard. I cannot do the soundboard myself. But, you know, we set up like we were a full, like 500 people could come in there. And it is, we're set up, you know. And we're not going to have 500 people in there. But I'm just saying, actually 500 people couldn't come in there, but 300 could. But my feeling about ministry is that whether we're preaching to 5 or whether we're preaching to 500, it doesn't matter. We're preaching the same message. We're not taking for granted the 5. And we're not getting too excited about the 500. We would be, but we're not, you know. But what we're saying is this, is that we're feeding the flock. And some of the accoutrements that we do, the things that we do to make it nice, that is not what makes it great. One day, back in the day when we only had the van, and we parked the van in a storage unit, there was one of those 30 foot by 10 foot, remember that, Rita, storage unit? And, you know, we had to kind of back the van into the storage unit. Like, you had this much room on either side. Well, we go, but there was a snowstorm, and it knocked out the power where the storage unit was. So the door wouldn't open to let us out. So, That was awesome. I never got in and out of church so fast. Somebody that day brought a box of 1,000 cups to donate to the church. And somebody had a jacket or something. I laid the jacket over it, and that was my pulpit. All we did, and somebody had a guitar. Danny Eaton was there. He had a guitar. We sang acoustically. I preached from a box of cups. We had no coffee. We had no anything. And it was, like, awesome. And then when we left, we all just left. We didn't spend an hour packing the van and the trailer. So there are good and bad with all of those things. But the Welcome Center did finally happen. And let me tell you, it's been an amazing addition to our church. Those are great things that you can do because it helps people see the vision. Those are small things where someone can get involved. And that's one of the things I'm supposed to be teaching is how to have people in your church get involved. Just standing at the door and greeting people is huge. It's huge. They're shaking someone's hand. I don't need to do bulletins every week. I mean, really? How much do we do? You know, we have Sunday church. We have Tuesday night Bible studies in two different locations. We have Wednesday night evangelism. We have Thursday night service. Sometimes we have Saturday evangelism. It's been on and off. We have Bible school during the semesters on Saturday. I mean, but really, how many bulletins do you need? Once a month, right? We do them every week on purpose, just so that we can have a point of contact, that someone gets their hand shook and someone gets a bulletin, something to have. It's a waste of money in one sense, but it's money well spent in another sense because you make that contact and you have a ministry for someone in your church that might be fairly new, but they are part of your team. Isn't that huge, Pastor Jason? When someone is part of your team, they've only been in your church for 4 months and they're already giving out bulletins at their door and they are so happy about their new church. Isn't that amazing? And then that's only where it starts. Brenda Mullins started out doing that and now she's setting up the whole Welcome Center. She's 65 years old. That's how old Colonel Sanders was when he started Kentucky Fried Chicken, you know? So we don't know. Brenda could be the beginning of the next mega church. She could be the next Joyce Myers for all we know. I don't know. What could it be? Yes, indeedy. She'll have her own study Bible. Anyway, so it's so important to have a vision as a pastor. It really is. I wasn't downplaying vision. A vision is important, because if I have a vision, and if I impart that vision, then other people will be recruited to the vision, because they want to be part of it. They want to be part of you. They want to be part of the team. But we don't just, the people that we recruit into our vision, now they become leaders. They become leaders. We train them. We feed them, but then we train them, and then they feed others, and then they train others, and that's how it works. So getting people involved, even in the very smallest way, setting up chairs, any which way that you can, helping break down if they're too lazy to get there early to set up. They can break down, you know, there's no problem. Anything that they can do, making a phone call, that's more for more mature people, but nonetheless, in some ways we are doing that actually. But we have to use the small portions of the body that are willing. If someone's willing to serve, let them serve, right? If someone's willing to serve, let them serve. Because, you know, when it comes to ministry, we were talking about commitment. You remember Woody Allen said 80% of success is showing up. I'm sure I don't know if he was the original, but he was one of them that said 80% is just showing up, letting people serve. Even if it's in the smallest way, it adds to the ministry. The University of California, this is an illustration, at Berkeley, agreed to coordinate an international effort to locate extraterrestrial life. We're still working on it. Apparently, they never saw the X-Files. But anyway, to accomplish this impossible task, Berkeley asked home computer users, listen to this, home computer users around the world, to contact them over the internet and download a program called SETI Home. SETI is it's an organization, it's a group of satellites that are constantly listening, you know, satellite dishes, or not satellites, but antennas, whatever they are. They're big dishes, satellite dishes, like listening. The SETI software makes a connection over the internet to a computer in California and downloads a work unit. That is a set of measurements from a particular part of the sky. The work unit is not large, but it takes the computer a while to crunch the numbers. When the work is done, the computer makes another internet call to Berkeley, uploads its results, and downloads a new work unit. What today's largest supercomputer could never do alone, over a million ordinary home computers can easily do. Isn't that something? Sometimes the best way to get a big job done is to do it in small portions, you know? Because I might not be able to pick up 100 bricks at a time, but I can pick up one, and I can carry it somewhere, then come back and get another one. And that's the whole idea. When we get people involved, just even in inviting people to church, like I was mentioning that friend Sunday, just getting them involved in inviting people to church, how simple is that? Just invite somebody. Here, I handed out one Sunday, we handed everybody one invitation. And it was their goal to give it out to anybody. They didn't even have to talk to them. It could be someone that they hated, someone that they loved, someone at the gas station. Just give away. Promise me you'll give this one invitation away. You know, it's just a little thing, but it's big. You know, because whenever we get the people involved at that level, number one, it will increase your attendance in church. I'm telling you, it will increase your attendance. So Maribel Santos and Marilyn Bryant, they are Costco shoppers. They're two ladies in our church. You know them, Ramir. They are Costco shoppers, and they just built a new Costco at the Wheaton Mall, which is 2 or 3 miles from our church. And they love Costco. And apparently so does every other Filipino in all of Montgomery County, because they're all there at Costco. And one Sunday, I think we had 25 new people, and they were all Filipinos. And they met every single one at Costco. It was amazing. You know, it was like, hey, Pastor, can we have more papers to give out at Costco? It's just amazing. You never know what can happen. I think at that time, Maribel had been in our church for 3 or 4 months. And she was already bringing so many people. And so it will increase attendance. You will see more conversions. Hey, the more people you bring in off the street, the more conversions you will see. Isn't that what we want? We can't disciple someone until they're converted. You know, we can't. And I'm telling you, it's wonderful to get Christians in. I mean, it's great, especially if they're really wanting to work, you know. But it also can be very disappointing. You know, we have this couple that was coming, and I was so excited. So excited. And they're wonderful. They're beautiful people. Gosh. Yeah. Anyways. Then I made the mistake of, when I saw their name, just, I had this hunch about them. They were just this handsome couple, you know, like mid-30s. And so I've done this before, but I've done it at work. I Googled their name. Then to find out that they're business owners and they were part of a big church up in Hoboken, New Jersey. And, you know, they're like, well, these are great Christians, you know. And the guy, they love the service. And then I got to talk to them a couple Sundays ago. And they're like, yeah, we've been in Silver Spring for 2 years. We've been looking for a church. We finally found a church. And we're moving in 3 weeks. You know, it's like, the discouragement, you know, because you have, you know what I mean? How many people have experienced discouragement? Because your hopes are high. Your hopes are high. Pastor Mati spoke about that yesterday in church, about how, you know, you're interested in this other person here because they look like they're very promising. But God is not maybe interested in them. He's interested in the one that you're ignoring. See, that's how it is, right? God's ways are not our ways. We look at the, just like Samuel. Samuel, the great prophet. Great, great, great prophet. And Samuel looked at all of David's sons, and every one, he said, surely this is the next king of Israel. But it was the son that wasn't there that was the one who was the next David. Of course, you know that. You've been to Bible college. So the other thing that we're going to see, when we allow people to do the smallest of all tasks and to begin to build in their relationship and their personal ownership of the church, is you're going to see more transformed lives. And there is nothing that will spur your church on more when you can point to a person and everybody knows that guy has changed. That woman was crazy before. You know, that, and we have them, you know, and maybe you were some of them. That woman was crazy. I had this lady one time, I baptized her in a styrofoam cup of water. She was so crazy, you know. It was hilarious. Another one that Rita was there for, yes. I mean, it was so, I just had to keep going at that point. She was deathly afraid of getting dunked. She's the only person that I've ever done the Catholic baptism with, you know. Like, and she was deathly afraid of water. And then, you know, other things. But I said, so we're in front of the church. It's this big, beautiful ceremony. It's like, so, Miss So-and-so, do you believe that Jesus, do you believe in Jesus as your Savior and Lord? You know, and then she said, I believe in you, Pastor Kim. I'm like, no, that does not count, you know. And I couldn't get her to say the right thing. So finally, I just said, okay, I baptize you in the name of Jesus. Now go sit down. We'll try it again later. I believe in you. She kept saying, I believe in you. And I'm like, oh, my face must have been getting redder and redder and redder. I'm like, I will never do that again. Baptize somebody in a styrofoam cup. That's what it is. But they are the key to our future, equipping the saints. Turn to Ephesians chapter 4 and verse 11. Equipping the saints is what we must do. We have to equip the saints. Because, well, number one, we're not going to be here forever. I remember thinking somehow, I'm sure somebody said this to me because I don't know how it would happen. Otherwise, I'm not that creative. But when I first got saved, somehow I thought that when we evangelized the world for the first time, the whole world, that Jesus would come back. You know, how many people think that? You see, I told you you were wrong. I know some of you would have probably raised your hand, especially young people. I would have. But this is the truth. The world has been evangelized over and over and over and over again. And it needs to be evangelized again. Each one of us is responsible to evangelize our generation. You understand that? It's got to happen again. And it's going to happen again. And it's going to happen again until Jesus returns. We're going to continue to evangelize new peoples, new people groups. We're going to continue to do this. And also our people here. It's not just new tribes. We've got a new tribe. They were just born last decade. And they need to be saved. They need to be evangelized. Part of the problem in America is that they're not necessarily being evangelized. Well, they are being evangelized, but they're being evangelized into the gay gospel. They're being evangelized into the atheist gospel. They're being evangelized into all things that are anything but evangel. They're not good news at all. But that's what they're being evangelized to. And we've allowed, as a nation, as a culture, the Western culture, we've allowed this to happen. And then we've allowed somehow the Muslims and, you know, some far Eastern European countries to gain the moral high ground somehow, right? I mean, I love Putin. I know if you're Ukrainian, I'm so sorry. I don't mean that. I don't really love him. But I love what he said. Are there any Ukrainians in here that are ready to shoot me? I'm so sorry. What I mean by that is he's a bad man. But he made a statement that he wants to defend the Christian church in Syria. Isn't that amazing? They do not want this, the Muslims, to take over. And I'm like, yeah, I wish somebody else would say that, you know. We are not going to allow the homosexual culture to take over our nation. Hello, would somebody else say that, you know? I mean, I'm just saying. You know, there are things, there's also deception, but the key to our future is that we need to evangelize our generation. We need to equip our generation. We have to teach our generation to evangelize the next generation. And they need to teach them to evangelize the next generation. That's why it's important that people go to church. That's why it's important that we always plant more churches. People think, oh, there's churches on every corner. I had a guy write to me, and some of you know him, and he was angry at me, and he probably had good reason. He left the church, then he came back, then he left again. And he's like, why do you even have a church in Silver Spring? There are churches, and he's right. There are churches almost on every corner. There's got to be 5 Methodist churches. And there's got to be 20 people 80 years older and above in each of those churches, you know, up and down, and a bunch of Baptist churches and a bunch of independent churches and a bunch of cultural churches from different countries and stuff like that. And like, he made this accusation, and it almost got to my heart, like, what do we need another church? I'm going to a Presbyterian church because their doctrine's great, you know, and so there you go. And I thought about it for a while. And I said, what, are you crazy? There aren't more churches, there's less churches. I believe the number was by Barna that 10,000 pastors quit every year in America, and there's not 10,000 that are replacing them. More churches close down every year by far than start. Isn't that something? Some of these church plants, even ones that we've done, they have not succeeded. They close down. It happens. But more closed than open. The Wheaton Baptist Church, they leveled. They sold it to a company that built a mall. And then they ended up merging with another church because of all kind of problems that they had. But the equipping of the saints is the most important thing that we can do as church planters once we begin to grow our church. And then we have to continue. And then we have to plant more churches from those church plants. We have to think about that and plan that. Ephesians 4:11. And he gave himself some to be apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, and some teachers. Listen, for the equipping of the saints. Who are the saints? They're the ones that are converted in our churches. They're the ones, that maybe the vagabonds who find a home in our church eventually. Maybe they're, like Silver Spring has a lot of people that are passing through for 3, 4, 5 year stints. And then they're moved on by the military or by an embassy or their job or whatever the case may be, you know, private job. But we equip them while they are here. They get involved while they are here. I remember Theo and Jeanette Lintzer with their 2 kids. They were with us for 4 years. And she told me that all the people at the Swedish embassy, the Christians, they were like jealous of them that they had found. They weren't necessarily Christians. Actually, I said Christian, but they weren't necessarily. Theo and Jeanette were. But that they had found a home and been able to participate in a church for the 4 years that they were here as embassy workers in the States, you know, in Georgetown. And it's like amazing, right? And then we're still friends with them, and they might even move back someday. But I'm just saying that they found a useful place, a place where they could express and use their gifts for the equipping of the saints for the work of the ministry. We have to equip the saints. That's our goal. That's our command, that we need to equip the saints, because God has given those people you and me. We are that gift. We are those pastors. We are those apostles. We are those prophets. We are those evangelists. We are those teachers. God has given us to them to equip them so they can become who we are and continue the work of Christ in the edifying, the building. When it means edifying, doesn't always mean just like, you are so wonderful. You know, and we see edifying, and, you know, we mean it, right? Oh, you are awesome. You know, that's awesome. Everything's awesome, you know, and you're amazing, and everybody's amazing, and wow, and, you know. Sometimes when people tell me it was a great message, you know, that's a great message. Pastor, that was a great message. What did you like most about it? It was great. You know, I mean, that's it. That was great. I'm glad you liked it. Have a nice day. Come back next week. And a great message. A great class, Pastor Shively. What'd you like about it? Yeah, it was great. Till we all come, it's an ongoing process. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God. I used to teach a 3-hour class on Friday nights here. For many years, it was called the Pentateuch, which I love. Anyways, I was the only excited person in that third hour, though. I mean, oh my God, it's Friday night. Most of these people are working. One night, it was when the classroom was over there, that all saw change. And it was a big class, actually. Justin Schaller is like there. He brought a coffee in, and they had this rule. They had new carpet, no coffee in there, you know. And I was just like messing around. I took the marker, and I would never have been a good pitcher, but I was a good lacrosse. Somehow I did a nice overhand just to have some fun to throw it at him. I hit his cup, and it exploded all over everybody, and all over his new Bible and everything like that. And I thought, class is over. Go in peace. And that was the end right there. But yeah, I was the only great class, Pastor. Honest to God, half the class didn't show up. I learned not to take that second break. The only person there is like Rachel Brown. Hi, Pastor. I am going to get the best grade in this class. She is still there. She's amazing. But, you know, that's how it goes. I don't know why I even talked about that. No breaks. No breaks! Only one break. The equipping of the saints. Okay, the unity of the faith, always, when all else fails, go back to the Bible. Till we all come to the unity of the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God, to a perfect man. Remember, we just talked about that. To a perfect man. To the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Remember, what is our goal? What is our goal? To build a megachurch, right? What is our goal? To heal people. What is our goal? Because shalom, shalom, Jerusalem, it means peace. And you know, peace means healing. And everybody should be healed if they have faith, because there is healing in the... Because Jesus didn't just die for our sins. He died for our well-being. Because that's in the Bible. You know what I mean? But, you know, I'm just, I don't know where I'm going. That's not our goal. That's right. It's not our goal to teach that. It's not true anyway. But it's not our goal to teach that. Our goal is to make the perfect man. To bring women and men to Christ. To present them. Right? It's not about us. It's not about building the biggest church. It might be about one disciple who will then go and build the biggest church. I don't know. But it's about one man. It's about bringing that person, being responsible to pour out what God has given us into them. And so, to the measure of the fullest of stature, that we should no longer be children tossed to and fro, carried about with every wind of doctrine by the trickery of men, the cunning craftiness of deceitful plotting shepherds. We shepherd people. We feed people. We protect people. But speaking the truth in love, that we may grow up in all things, into him who is the head, from whom the whole body, joined and knit together by what every joint supplies, according to the effective working by which every part does its share, causes growth to the body for the edifying of itself in love. I remember we had this guy, maybe you remember him, Pastor Luigi, his name was Felix, one of the first, you know, kind of African guys, not kind of African, he was definitely African. I think he was from Congo, maybe? His brother-in-law worked for the World Bank. Everybody works for the World Bank, you know? They're all broke, but they work for the World Bank anyway. But he was so happy to bring soda one night, you know, to the little Methodist church that we were borrowing at the time. You know, just people are glad to do things, and then when we use them, they are used, and they're happy to be used, and they hopefully move forward in the faith. But, The who is more important than the what. The individual person is more important than what we're doing. It's they are important. You know, what do I mean by that? Who someone is in Christ is more important than what they do for the church. You ever run into that? You ever feel like, man, you're trying to get people to do stuff, and sometimes they resist. And you want them to do things, but you can't always do that. Not everybody will enter the program. We first have to feed them. We first have to invest in them. Some might start wanting to do things right away, but some might take their time. and they have reasons for. Maybe they've been hurt. Maybe their husband left them with their two kids and then married your first cousin and had a kid with them. Gee. That person might need some healing, you know? That's a truth story right there. That person might need some healing, you know? Beautiful family. Might need some healing, though. They might not be doing everything all at once. They might be really concerned about their kids. They might be really concerned that you know, they're growing up in the Lord, that they're finding truth finally. And they might just need not to be pushed, but just to be loved. There's that side, too. And there are people that aren't just there on purpose to be wallflowers, like we read that funny thing at the beginning, you know, about the asking people to leave the church because they're taking up too many spaces. That is not what we do. That is just joking. But there are people that just need to come and sit and be loved by the body, as we were by the body, you know. They are more than they themselves are more important than what they do. Amen. You are more important than what you do to God. And, you know, but the who they become, who they become in Christ will determine what they do. You know, you wonder, you know, I mean, when Pastor Stephen started, you know, reaching out and growing, he was concerned first, I believe, he was. He presented the vision. But he was very concerned with training people, with raising up people, men, women, absolutely. But he also never forgot the fact that they were people, right? He never forgot the fact that they needed to be loved. Because without the who, there would be no what. Without the who, there would be no ministry. There would be no work being done. There would be no evangelism being done. The who is very important. And we are the who and we are the what's as well. What we do is based on who we are, but who we are is more important to God than what we do. We need to make disciples. God will determine what they do. We will help them in that way. But none of this will happen without the vision of the leader. The leader has to have a vision. Leaders at whatever level. Your leaders, you have to teach them vision as well. You have to teach them vision, to be disciplined by their vision. And vision is needed for the church. Vision is needed for all churches. It's needed for a church, and it's needed for its leaders. But you must also have passion for Christ and his people. Did you hear that? We need vision. Vision is important for the church. Vision is important for the leaders. But you must also have passion for Christ and his people. That is so important. Passion. Passion for Christ and his people. It is better to have passion with no vision than to have a vision with no passion. Do you hear that? It is better to have passion with no vision than a vision with no passion. What can that do for us? If you have passion, the vision will follow, and so will the people. Isn't that right? The vision will come if you have passion for the lost. The vision will come. It always does. And the people will follow the vision because they're also following the passion. They know that you love them. You know, I've probably said this more than once, but Francisco Lopez was this fellow, Frank Lopez from Texas, down along the border with Mexico. He was very high ranking in the Border Patrol back in 2006. He came to our church when it was very new. 2006, we were like months old. It was probably right after I got back from Korea that first time visiting you all. And so he came and he was cool. We talked and then he said, I want to meet with you, Pastor. I met with him downtown Silver Spring. Well, when I met him, he had his Border Patrol outfit on. I'm like, whoa, dude, Border Patrol. Man, half our church is Latino. We better watch out. Nobody's going to come, you know. And so they're all illegal. Anyway, so Francisco, he's having some marriage problems at the time. His wife was he was for the Border Patrol. She was a customs agent. Well, he had taken this deal that the government offered him to give him this very high rank, going from just basic working the Border Patrol thing. He was kind of high up there, too, but now he was in D.C. He was one of the top guys. But his wife, they moved all their stuff up there, but then his wife and his two sons ended up not coming. She said, I'm not going to Washington. She said, you go to Washington. Have a nice day. Apparently, they're, you know, Mars, Venus, all that stuff, you know, whatever. But she didn't come. So he was in a quandary, you know, what should I do? Well, he had been coming for a few weeks, you know, and I said, Frank, you got to go home. You got to go back. You got to give up your position. You got to go home. Again, another disappointment. The guy started the chaplain program for all of the Border Patrol. He was the head chaplain. Not only did he have a high position, but he also he ministered and discipled all the chaplains. I was like, oh, I got this guy in my church. Like, we are like, whoo, we're going high, baby. Mega temple. But anyways, what did Frank say one day? He came in, he said, you know, Pastor, he said, I've been in a lot of churches. He said, but I've never felt so loved, you know, as being in this church. And I said to the team at that time, I made a big deal out of it. I said, listen, if we mess up everything, but we get that right, we're going to be okay, you know, we're going to be okay. If we're loving people, we're going to be okay, because that's the passion of Christ, to love people. God loves people, and so do we. And so, if you have passion, the vision will follow, and the people will come too. So, you know, we have to discover really what our area needs, what people need in our area. And it's very interesting. You know, we've done so many things over the years. We've tried so many things. Talked about the outdoor bookstore and how that was going to make the church, like, amazingly huge. And it didn't, you know, and all these other things that didn't pan out. But there were still efforts that had fruit somewhere along the line. And we were always, I have failed at so many things. I've failed at so many more things than I have been successful at. Nonetheless, I'm glad that I went and tried each one of those things, because if I didn't, I wouldn't have known. And then it might not have, you know, it might not have ushered me down the right track on the maze, if you will. You know, I mean, I tried that one, the maze, you know, but I tried that one in the maze, tried that one in the maze, tried that, and there was a monster, you know, all kinds of things. But in the end, it's all about just having that passion. It's all about having that vision, discovering the gifts of your people. That's huge. Have you discovered gifts in your churches? It's amazing, isn't it? It's surprising sometimes. Like, to hear Dwayne preach with the passion that he preaches at those prayer meetings, it's like amazing. Half of it, he's reading it, you know, from a devotional or something, but it's like he does it with, he believes it all with his heart, and people respond to it. And to see people sing, and to see people for the first time get out there, and you know what a great blessing? I took that group out soul winning that time with David and Teresa, and others, it was their first time as well. But they were not as skittish, maybe. But I remember going out and being so happy for one of the people in my church that someone they spoke to came to church that next day, you know? And I said, how did you find? Well, you know, so-and-so invited me last night in front of the theater, went down in Silver Spring, and I said, oh. And I walked him right up to him. I said, you remember this guy? And they like, wow. Like, it works. I can actually talk to somebody, and they will come. And that is a, it's a great awakening, if you will, for people to see that that can happen. Okay, so we're going to shift away from that a little bit. So, yeah, so investing in your people, giving people the tools that they need to get the job done, transferring that passion in your preaching. I got to say one thing about preaching. You got to preach with passion. You got to not only believe what you're saying. It doesn't mean you have to rant and rave like I do once in a while. It just means that you got to believe what you're saying. You got to be prepared, right? But you got to believe what you're saying. And you have to allow the Holy Spirit to take you to places that you might not go. Now, that cannot be an excuse. This is not a preaching class. But that cannot be an excuse for unpreparedness. Be prepared. Be prepared to read every note that you wrote. But don't be locked into your notes. Allow God and have that. I have like this mindset of prayer. Lord, well, there's two things. Bless these people despite my weaknesses, number one. But number two, speak through me to every need in this room. And ask and believe that God will do that. And I believe that God will do that. And people will grow. And people will come up to you and say, how did you know? How did you know? Thank you so much. That spoke to me. Maybe not everybody, but somebody will. And that spoke. And you're like, really? Because I was thinking about it in the shower today, you know, and that's how prepared I really was. Not that that ever happens to me. But I remember going to a big, big Bible conference. Big, big. 1,500 pastors in the Midwest also. And it was this famous guy. And I wanted to be where he was because he's a great preacher. He's on the radio and stuff. And so all these guys are hitting him with all this. They have breakout groups, you know, after the main sessions. And so they're asking him, hey, well, when do you start preparing for your Sunday message? And he just quipped, Saturday night. You know, but of course it's not true. He's probably got them all stacked up. But maybe sometimes it is. You know, he was just being real, I think. It happens. But one of the things that we must understand beyond that preaching, beyond the... Well, let's keep on preaching. You cannot expect to look over your Bible for 15 minutes and that whether you're doing a Bible study, whether you're doing a women's group, whether you're doing Sunday school for little kids or adults, you can't expect more than a few times to, you know, look at the Bible for 15 minutes, oh, yeah, you know, get something going in your head. Okay, I'm good. You know, I'm good. Because this is what's going to happen. You're gonna say those few things that are new, and then you're simply going to fall back to whatever you're comfortable with. If it's baptism, if it's justification, like, that's my favorite subject. So if I'm, you know, if I'm talking about Romans chapter 5 and 6 and chapter 4, you know, I might, if I'm not prepared, I might fall back into, not that it's a bad subject, it's just my fallback plan. It's my rhetoric, if you will. I know that's a terrible thing to say. But some preachers, every preacher has their favorite subject. Every preacher also has these lines of rhetoric that we just kind of shoot out as if they were, you know, very deep, but we've said them 1,000 times. And those are things that are indicators, if we're saying them over and over and over again, that we're not prepared, that we're not receiving from God, that we're not spending the time that it takes to hear from God and reading our Bibles. Because sometimes just reading our Bibles, read the Bible. This is where we get God speaking to us. We pray to Him. He speaks to us through His Word. So being prepared, it costs your Saturdays. It costs your Fridays. It might cost your Monday mornings. It might cost your Wednesday night. It might cost you all day just preparing for a 30-minute message. It might cost you 3 weeks of thinking about it and writing things down to prepare for some special thing that you're going to be speaking on. But it's so much better to be prepared than to be speaking rhetoric. Before you go and begin a church, before you begin a new ministry, before you begin a ministry within the church, you have to do one thing. You've got to count the cost. You've got to weigh your commitments. How many years am I willing to do? How many days am I willing to do this? How many months? How many years? Will I do it for my whole life? I remember that first year, actually the first months in Silver Spring, some of those first members, they said, well, some guy that I talked to said that you guys are just going to, you know, be here for a little while, then you're going to go back to Baltimore. And I said, that's not true. And I truly believed it wasn't true. That's not true. We are here for the long haul. I might die here, you know. I mean, like, whatever. I was a young 45 years old back then, but or 46, whatever it was. But, you know, this is the thing about it. I made that statement. I don't know that I actually did count the cost. But now I realize there is a cost. Everything good costs something. You got to count the cost before you plan your church, because you might lose your family if you don't. You might lose your wife if you don't. You might lose your dog if you don't. But then just play a country song in reverse and you'll get them all back, right? That's the joke. There are costs that you have to count. You have to have oneness with your spouse. And you need to have oneness with your team. And you have to communicate the passion that you have to your team, but also understand that their commitment might not be your commitment in that sense. They might have a one-year commitment. They might have a one-month commitment. I remember when we had people that were very committed until, and I don't blame them, until we started Sunday morning church, because they didn't want to miss Sunday morning church here. And I understood. I understand. And they were no longer on the team. Fine. We got a new team. Rita started coming, and that was all I needed. You know, she was amazing. And we knocked on doors together, and Joe Ardone is still there after we walked into his yard when he's blowing leaves. He's still crazy as ever, but you know what? He always shakes my hand. He's like, Basil, how do you come up with that stuff? You know? How do you come up with that stuff? But passion. Passion costs something. The desire to see people come to Christ costs something. It cost Jesus everything, didn't it? It costs the Father everything. God sends the originals, you know, to help, the original team to help. And whether you have a team of locals or a team of originals, it's going to cost them something to participate. I see some of these folks now that are there, and I'm like, I almost want to apologize. You know, like, wow, you're here every Sunday morning. You do this every Sunday morning. I'm so sorry, but I'm not sorry. I'm happy. You know, I'm happy that they're doing it and not me, and they're not sorry. They've counted the cost, and they've determined that it's worth it. They determined that they're growing in the Lord, and this is what God wants them to do, and they've determined that they need to do those things, right? The field needs us, but much more we need the field, right? I'm not the first one to say that, but that is so true. But counting the cost, really thinking about it, really weighing your commitment. Because something's going to happen in the middle of your church planting, and it's called crisis. You're going to have crises. You're going to have days that you just don't want to get up. You just don't want to go. You just don't want to go. It's like the mother that was waking up her son for Sunday morning church. And she said, come on, honey, get up. We got to go to church. And the son said, I'm not going to church today. And the mother said, what do you mean you're not going to church? He said, I'll give you two reasons why I'm not going to church. He said, number one, those people can't stand me. And number two, I can't stand those people. And the mother said, well, I'm going to give you two reasons that you are going to church. Number one, you're 49 years old. And number two, you're the pastor. Now let's go, you know. It's just... You know, it's like we don't, you know, we go through these crises where we just don't want to do it. I remember that first year, we are subject to the school closings because we meet in a school. And I remember being so happy when I was like, they closed the school. I'm so happy. And back then we were like doing nothing. We're setting up a couple speakers and, you know, a set of drums. And we were all here, and Pastor Shaw was like, hey, what are y'all doing? It's snowing. They closed the school. I forgot to tell Pastor Ron that they closed the school, Ron Swingle. He drove all the way down. He's like, oh, hey, Pastor Ron. Oh, my God. I forgot. I knew the night before, and I forgot. It was after I don't know what it was. It was after some event. But anyway, hey, that's no longer the case. I hate when church happens. We don't have church, we don't get the offering, and we can't pay the bills, so it's really hard. But see the practical thing? That's a crisis right there, a crisis waiting to happen. Your people also are going to go through crises, and we need to be there for them in their crisis. Church planning is a little different. You know, you don't have Pastor Jason and his team. You don't have the support staff that you have here. Which doesn't always mean anything, but at the same time, actually, some people are afraid of big churches more than they are of small churches. have this Lacey Weinblatt is her name. She's from Oregon. And she's coming for a while. She's going to move up here to Baltimore. And I told her, I said, hey, we have a church in Baltimore. She's like, really? It's so good because she loves our church. And I said, yeah, it's like 1,500 people. She's like, oh, my God, you know, that's scary. That's not, she's not the first person. They're scared of big churches. And then I said, because she's going to be living downtown, I said, well, we have a new church starting on Federal Hill, so I'm gonna try to direct her over there when she does move up here for school. But new people will come in. New people will leave. The cross will happen. We'll have a lot of disappointments. But the reward is amazing, isn't it? And the fact that we are a family, the fact that we've got people who love us and people who I am closer with than they can't even imagine. People that have been in my church, a girl that got saved in our church, gosh, it seems like it was yesterday, but it was December of 2013, Michelle Mullins. She came to this. She works at University of Maryland. She's some type of public director thing or something. She's only 24. But she came to the church because she just decided that she needed to know more about God. So she read the book of Revelation. How do you start the book of Revelation? I don't know. I started with Ezekiel. That was special. But anyway, but she read the book of Revelation and she said, we're living this today. And then she got on the internet. And somehow she found us on the internet and found our Facebook page. And she's a social media person because that's what she does for work. And so she came and I wasn't there. I was here. I was preaching here that Sunday morning. And she probably wouldn't have come back. But Pastor Bailey was preaching that day for me. I was preaching here for Pastor Schaller. And she thought, well, she says she was going to church shop. She was church shopping. And she said, well, just to be fair, I'm going to wait till next week. I'm going to come again next week and see the pastor and see what he's like. So I came back, and of course, that closed the deal right there, you know. But anyways, she came back, and she never stopped coming. She brought her mother, and now her mother's part of the ministry. They both do a lot in the ministry. This family, I mean, it seems like they would do anything for me. They're just so happy to know the Lord, so happy that then she got baptized. She brought 60 people to her baptism, most of them unsaved, and they all heard the gospel, and they all saw her get baptized. See, that's the work of the ministry. We have to make sure we're work. See, God has a calling for us to a local church. And this is what's important, is that our gifts are used at a local level. This is why we have a pastor, you know, and our pastor teaches us, and our pastor equips us. And then we go and we equip others, you know. But the commitment costs money. It costs time. It costs our life. Are we committed to driving? Are we committed to hours of study? Are we committed to listening to people's life story? And sometimes they're just not interesting. That's the funniest thing. They're just not interesting. But I'll never forget Steve Taylor. You know, I worked for him for many years, and it's so true. Everybody wants somebody to listen to them. But nobody wants to. He said, don't you tell your story to anybody because they don't care. They just want you to listen to them. And it's so true. I mean, you know, to an extent, it's true, unless they have a certain makeup, you know. But, you know, we listen to their life story. We listen to their hurts. And we become partners in a sense. We hurt when they hurt, actually. We listen to their complaints. We listen to their attitudes, which are not always spiritual, you know. They don't have a spiritual outlook. You know, you preach this, what you think is an amazing message, and they don't even know what you're talking about. And you think, how can that be? And you just have to go back to when you, because I think I preach a simple message, but actually, it is simple. But it's not simple to them. They don't even know what you're talking about. They think Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen, I go to communion, or they think whatever I can do for God, maybe I'll get. You know, they're thinking on the worldly level. They're not thinking on the level that we're thinking. They are not mature Christians. talking the newer, but as people grow, they also will suffer because they will understand that their commitment to Christ has got to be greater for them to grow. And sometimes we as leaders become kind of the sounding board for their pain, the sounding board for the cross. We maybe even represent their pain. If it wasn't for you speaking to me on the street one day, I would have a boyfriend. I would have a life. I would have a job. I wouldn't be stuck here in Silver Spring, Maryland. I'd be somewhere having a good time with my rock and roll buddies in Las Vegas or whatever the case may be, you know. We have to be simple. Be simple. We have to be faithful. We have to be simple. We have to be faithful. And we have to not give up. We have to not give up. That's it. That's the crux. It's the simplicity. It's counting the cost, understanding that it costs us everything. Simple, faithful, don't ever quit. Just keep moving on with God and making those disciples. And that is church planning in my experience. Any questions? Comments?
Can you speak again about all of some example about the crisis you can face in church planting and how...
The crises we face in church planting. I'll give you a crisis, right? Want to hear a great one? This is a personal crisis and then the crisis for the person. It was this woman, and she was great, awesome. One of our first people in the church, new people. First, you know, to our new location. And I think we had about 7 people coming, and then we gained another 10 or so in our church, in our door knocking at first, before we had our first Sunday morning service. We had a Sunday afternoon service before that. Anyways, after about a year or so, this woman had this incredible infatuation for me. It was like, I had no idea. She was like maybe 10 years older than me, you know, and she had a boyfriend, and she wrote me this letter. Talk about crisis. I should have kept it. But I always do stupid things. I should have kept it just for my own, you know, like, safety. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, she really is crazy. See, you know, and she wrote me this long love letter. Did that ever happen to you, Pastor Steve? I mean, my wife is teaching Sunday school, like, in the next room. And this woman gives me this love letter and asks me in the letter to leave my wife and run away with her. And I'm like, I'm so stupid. I mean, all I can say is, I'm just like, I should have just said to her at that point, you really should find another church. But I didn't, because I'm an idiot. And I don't know if I would ever make that same mistake. But, you know, at that point, she was thoroughly embarrassed. I don't even know what to say. Should have been embarrassed for even writing the letter, but let alone having me read it right in front of her. She said, please read this right now. And I was like laughing, you know, because like I'm like, really? Because I'm married to Casey, and those are all my 5 kids right there, and you're crazy? It was so crazy. You didn't know that, Rita. You know who I'm talking about, too. Well, that's just as well. Anyway. It went downhill from there, and she had a crisis. She didn't know who she was. I thought she was saved. She never got saved. A whole bunch of people that I thought were saved were not saved, I believe, now. Maybe some of them were, but there's no fruit, and I think that they just thought it was cool that they could just walk to our church, you know, and there was like, hey, there's a church in the school, and it just was crazy. But that was so weird. So that was a crisis for me, a crisis for her. So are you talking about crisis for me? Or any crisis, just crisis. Let's talk about crisis. I had another crisis. I had this wonderful Christian woman from Africa, African, you know, from that country called Africa over there, you know what I mean? I forget which country she was from, actually. Definitely in the neighborhood of Africa. And Her husband, though, his name was Mustafa. She's a Christian. Mustafa is a Muslim. And Mustafa found out his wife was coming to our church. And then he threatened me. And I looked right in Mustafa's face. I said, Mustafa, you're in the United States of America. And I've got the number of the Montgomery County Police right here, you know. And I will call them, you know. But it was just like, these are crazy things that happen. People come and they threaten you. You know, these are some wild things. And the poor woman was beaten and her kids were beaten. And I just felt so bad for her, you know. But there was not a lot I could do because I didn't want to get beaten, actually. But in terms of crises, most of the crises in our church have to do with people. Like, we had a situation where a man started dating a woman in our church. And then they did more than dating, you know. And then I found out about it later. And then I made another mistake of not confronting him right away, but trying to work through it at the request of the woman who still wanted to come to the church. And that blew up in my face. And it was a big crisis. And we almost had a church split, like, which, you know, half of 30 people would have been gone. You know what I mean? Because there was these sides. And everybody, this was the funniest thing. This is how stupid you can be as a leader, especially if you're me. The woman says to me, whatever you do, don't tell him that I told you. Okay. And I'm trying to think, how does that work? You know? So I'm working with, I love the guy, you know? I really loved him. Well, in the meantime, she told everybody in the church. So it's just me and the other guy that are like, we're, you know, blindsided. Well, then he found out that I knew, and that's when all hell broke loose, you know? And I was like, now I've got to deal with my own stupidity. When you should always do, if you have to do church discipline, you just got to do it. You cannot worry. And this is something that it took me a while to learn, Pastor Steve. He had already learned it. But you can't not deal with it, because in not dealing with it, you're hurting your church much more than you are in dealing with it. Nobody wants to go through the pain of losing a few people, but how about the pain of losing half your church? How about the enduring pain of that person hating you for the rest of your life? You know, maybe not hating you, but not ever being your friend again because they don't trust you. I mean, those are real mistakes that people make. And sometimes the crises are our mistakes. And I just have to say that was a mistake, and I plead forgiveness. I plead forgiveness. I plead forgiveness from the church and from the individuals. So, and this is something that we need to also learn as Christians, as leaders, is not to be proud. I had that man come back to our church because he was blabbering to everybody, and I almost lost another key couple because he was bad-mouthing me to them, and it was a full-blown crisis. Full-blown, I want to quit and go home and talk to my wife and just go to church on Sunday with Pastor Schaller because it's easier. And this person, who was a big person in my church, demanded that I come to his house and demanded that I meet with this person, with him and his wife. The other guy was single. And so I did. And I was cold as ice. I was like, yep, I've heard it all before. And then I said, something happened in my heart. And I told the person, it was kind of like me reconciling with my wife in a sense. But I said to him, well, this is what you did to me. And I laid out to him the problems that he caused me. But I said, listen, it's all my fault. And I realized it really was all my fault, because I didn't deal with it. I knew there was no reason I shouldn't have confronted him. There was no working around it, loving him out of it, you know, all that kind of, it just wasn't going to happen. So I said to the man, I'm sorry. And I didn't feel the full brunt of it, but I invited him to come to church the next day. We had a good crowd. And in the church service, before I preached, I was preaching on forgiveness because I needed it. I was hoping that he would listen and forgive me, actually. But before I preached, I said, this person is here. And I, and we, and the other person, the woman, was there as well. I and we have sinned against this man. And I, for 10 or 15 minutes, I talked about what we had done and how wrong it was. And I mean, he was really wrong in so many ways also, but it didn't matter. I was wronger than he was wrong. And so in that crisis, what happened was we stopped and we prayed. And in the middle of church service, everybody got up and they began to weep. And other people were forgiving people for other things. You know, and really, I'm not even kidding. There was a woman that was here in Bible school, and she had felt that she had been offended by another person. So she left Bible school and came back to Silver Spring. And the person that offended her was there. And she walked over to that person and said, I forgive you. And you know, whatever. But it kept going on and on. And it was beautiful. And then I eventually said a few more words, but that was it. It was amazing. It was amazing. It didn't actually end there, but it was still a very healing time for our entire, and thank God that the guy who I was a little angry at for forcing me to come and confront this situation did that, and he was mature enough. I was not. And I did, and he did, and God did an amazing work. And I'm glad, because I've learned that it's not worth it to be right, is it? I learned it in my marriage a long time ago, but I had to learn it in church too. I've learned it with my kids a long time ago, but I never learned it as a pastor of a church, that it's better to repent to your congregation than try to justify your actions when other people can't understand the whole situation. Better to grab it at one big net and say, listen, I was wrong. Not going to get into this. I just was wrong, and please forgive me. You know, because there's no way. It's like capturing the wind. It's not going to happen. If you let it keep going, then people will follow rabbit trails every which way, and most of them will lead away from your church and away from fellowship, and you'll just have a big splinter group talking about how bad your church is on Facebook. And so, I mean, that's what we've come to, isn't it? So that was a big crisis, and thank God that that was healed. Then I had another one. And it had to do, we had this amazing Bible study that we started a few years ago, and it was going so well. And then all of a sudden, this person comes in to the Bible study, and they start causing all this, start chattering and talking about the leader, who is one of our guys from here, and you know, how unprepared he was, and how he didn't know what he was talking about, and it like got around, and all of a sudden, I didn't even know what was going on. I had gotten the Bible study going with that person, and it was really successful. And new people were coming right in. It was great. This new group of people was all coming to this Bible study. But then all of a sudden, I was looking at a church split with all these real promising people, that new girl being one of them. Man, I went right to the source. And I said, we got to knock this off. And I went to the guy who there was caught, and there was some things that he was doing that weren't right, and he wasn't prepared. He really wasn't prepared. But there were issues. But I learned that I had to deal with it straight on, and I did. And I talked to these people, and one, thankfully, one man in the Bible study. Oh, and then I went and had dinner at the people who had the Bible study's house, and I talked to them, and they had a lot of complaints. And they were fairly new to the church, less than a year at that time. And we prayed. And I talked to this one guy who really had a grasp of what was going on. And then I talked to another couple that had a real grasp. And I said, the devil, and I said to him, the devil is trying to get in here and ruin this new movement of God. And we're going to pray this thing out of here. And we did. And we had our prayer meeting was going on then. The prayer meeting, I'm sure that God heard us and he brought all these new disciples. But then the devil heard us too, or he saw us, and he wanted to destroy it. And God didn't let him. And it led to great healing amongst that group of people. And now we have more Bible studies. And those people are even like growing themselves personally. And one of them is going to get a license to preach soon and all this. So God is doing a great work in that sense. So, yeah, crises are going to happen. And I think, yeah, humility and understanding that I'm not always right. Yeah, not even with my kids. I'm not always right. So, any other questions?
How do you know? I just see Pastor Schaller sometimes being very gentle and patient, like incredibly patient, incredibly gentle with crazy circumstances. But then also I see him very not afraid at all to confront and immediately deal with things. Any experience or advice on that?
I don't know. It depends on how public it is, I suppose. You know, if something has, if there's controversy in the church and it has become really public, and like public knowledge, then I think it might need to be addressed publicly from the pulpit, but I think that that's rare. I think that it's probably better to deal with situations on a personal level first and then deal with those other things in generalities if possible. I don't know any particular situation that you're speaking about, but certainly the bathing suits, you know, that's fine, you know. Covered head to toe. Last night's message, was that last night's message, the bathing suits? No bikini, hijab bikinis. We're going with hijab bikinis, but do you know what hijab bikinis are? They're pretty funny. Swim with modesty. Anyways, but I don't know if was that controversial to anybody last night. I bet it was to some young people.
I walked out with somebody who was. Yeah.
I bet it was with some people, right?
I guarantee you.
Yeah, I know a girl in our church that went to school with some shorts that I didn't approve of. It was my daughter, and she goes to Bel Air High. She's going to be a senior next year, and I said, "Really?" And she's like, I mean, they weren't like that high, but still, a lot of leg, you know. And I'm like, she's like, yeah, you know, they don't really enforce the code. I'm like, I don't care if they don't enforce the code. I care what you're thinking. Like, why would you dress like that in school? I don't care about a code. I care about your heart, you know. But anyways, so I'm just joking about the bathing suits. So I was just... I didn't know, so some people were offended, right?
I would just say defensive.
Defensive, yeah. Yeah. I'm going to wear a t-shirt all the time now when I go swimming. It's more to protect people than anything else, you know? Yeah. But, what was the question? Oh, so from the pulpit, yeah. So from the pulpit, so you're talking about things where maybe there's gossip.
I don't really have specific.
Maybe there's unforgiveness. I think those are great, awesome subjects that we can deal with. I'm actually, you know, like, of course, I'm in a small church. So if I've just talked to somebody about a situation and then I hammer that situation, they're kind of going to know I'm talking about them, you know. And I think even in a big church, if you just talked about a situation and the person happens to be there, you know, it might they might get a hint that you're kind of referring to what they just talked to. So I would probably be careful to keep it personal and keep it at that level and maybe speak if it need be addressed later in more generalities. But, I mean, I don't know if that sounds like I'm going against what I just said earlier, but I think that especially in small churches, you want to deal with things on a personal, private level best you can, especially church discipline. Like, I don't know that church discipline, I think the pulpit itself will discipline us, and it should, and we shouldn't be afraid to preach what the Bible says. The Bible is its best, the Bible interprets itself the best. We don't need to soften up the message of the gospel, do we? We don't need to soften up Jesus' words. All we need are Jesus' words, and that'll shake you up pretty good right there, you know? What? Die daily? What? Oh, how to lose a mega church in one day, Jesus. 5,000 people down to a dozen. Hey, that's what happened. Jesus had a mega church. Let's write that book, Pastor Stan. How to lose a mega church in one easy step. Eat my flesh. Two, eat my flesh and drink my blood. Ah, Are there any fish and bread involved? No. Okay, goodbye. 5,000. They all left him, except for the disciples. And he said to them, why don't you go with them? And they said, we got nowhere to go. So I guess Jesus dealt with some things, you know, in that sense. So if we speak the words of Jesus, then, you know, we don't have to soften those words. And I think sometimes we do. Pastor Steve. Save me.
Pastor Pete's question. Something I've done a number of times is like when there's an issue, like to deal with it, like personally with a person where it's their offender or their issue, but then like in kind of counseling them, actually coming to the point asking, hey, would it be okay? Can I bring this up in the pulpit? Because I think
That's good.
There's many, many people in the whole church, and like just like, Don't surprise them with it, but actually talk with them and agree with them and say, hey, you know, this is an amazing opportunity. And
right, which is kind of what I did with the forgiveness thing on that one person. Right. That's right. Well, that's great.
The majority, you know, not just one person, but it affects, like you're saying, affects a lot of people.
Mm.
And you talk to that individually rather than do that, just bring the subject to the church,
right,
which covers a lot of portions. Leads, speak to them individually.
Well, that's amazing. You ask for their permission, essentially.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like, just think, you know, this is a teachable moment. This is something we all need to hear. And
we don't say teachable moment here.
Okay.
We say preachable moment. I'm sorry. I'm going to talk about it in church, but if you want to come. Anyone else? Pastor Bamouni. The fact that we can counsel somebody in a situation. That person's going to go see other people.
Pour expliquer, mais la moitié de la chose qu'on savait, sur laquelle on s'est basé pour apporter un conseil.
Go ahead. Une autre fois.
Voilà, je viens de votre église.
I come in your church.
Il y a quelqu'un qui a une situation que vous traitez avec lui.
There is somebody and they are having a situation and you deal with the situation.
Mais comme je suis régulier chez vous, la personne vient vers moi pour expliquer la même chose, mais pas exactement.
So I'm coming regularly to your church and the person comes to talk to me to say the same thing, but not exactly.
Et moi, je lui donne un conseil basé sur ce que j'ai entendu.
And I give advice based on what I heard.
Mais ce n'est pas tout ce que vous savez.
It's not what, all what you know.
Mm. En fait, la personne justifie, trouve un moyen de pouvoir justifier un peu son attitude. Quoi.
Find a way to justify their attitude.
Et puis elle le fait avec plusieurs personnes.
And the person does it with many different persons.
Ça peut être vraiment un peu compliqué.
Finalement. Yeah, so, right, that is complicated because people... If they don't agree with your counsel, right? They don't agree with your counsel. And then they talk to other people and say, look, he said this to me. And this, but they don't know the whole situation, right? And this is why we can't listen to that person. Yeah, and we have to teach our people that, right? But it can really, that's a crisis waiting to happen right there. Especially if the person has standing in the church. Right? Like they're not going to listen to a person that's a known alcoholic maybe or a known offender of whatever, you know, some... But if it's someone that has stature, maybe your assistant or your wife or somebody... just kidding. You know, then they might listen to them. But are you asking how do we deal with that? Kick them out of the church. I think we have to, I mean, if we find out about it before we no longer have a church, then we should probably meet with that person and anybody else affected by the calamony, the gossip. I call it gossip, call it slander, whichever it is. So that's something we really need to deal with, right? Head on. We can't let it. It's like a sore that won't heal otherwise. I mean, when that person left the church that I was telling you about, where that I had forgiven, we had the time of forgiveness in the church, I was really happy when he left. Because it was easier for me not to have to deal with it. It's much easier that he just left, But it wasn't the right thing, because then the attitudes festered and it wasn't clean. So even if someone leaves, it's better that they leave somehow, if it's possible, with some type of understanding of what went on and stuff like that. But it's hard to figure out exactly what to say about a situation that I'm not exactly aware of the details, But in general, I would say that we're better off facing those type of things head on once we find out about them than it is to let them fester. To let them kind of continue. It's like if you don't deal with a cold, then it becomes bronchitis. Then you've got double pneumonia, And because you didn't deal with it. And so it is better to deal with it if you can up front. But, Any other questions?
Yeah, you were talking about how we, especially pastors, you need to spend some time listening to people's hurts and complaints. I was just wondering if you can that be balanced a little? If you're not a pastor, to what extent?
I mean, the body of Christ.
It can be very negative for ourselves.
Yeah, I know. Like, if it's too much for you, then it's good to, this is why Pastor Jason left as soon as I said that, because that's what he hears all the time. But, to recommend that they speak to someone in counseling, or they get counseled by someone, or speak to the pastor, or if you are a church member and someone was hurt by the church or is complaining about the church, then that is different. That's more then you need to talk to somebody about that. When I was talking about the hurts, I was thinking more like the case that I mentioned where the woman's husband left her and then slept with her cousin and got her cousin pregnant, and they're living happily ever after while she's dealing with, a divorce and two kids. So that's the kind of hurt that I was more referring to, not the hurt that was seemingly a complaint about the church, but more that people have legitimate hurts or their husband is in prison. And their son's in prison, and their daughter's in prison, and they should be in prison, but they're not, But, that kind of thing. I mean, I do have people that complain to me about things like that, that I don't have time to visit them, or I didn't visit somebody that they knew in prison or whatever, and I'm really bad with prisons. It's like a big deal, But also I'm busy. Busy in the sense that I legit have a 50-hour a week job, and so it's hard to do everything. So people have the right to complain, and then I say things like, I say, well, then maybe you should find another church where they have a full-time pastors, and I'm like, because it would be easier for me if you just went away, So I still have a little of that attitude. But always, if people have complaints about the church, always direct them to the church leadership. If people are just body members that are hurting, then if we have the maturity to help them and to listen to them and to comfort them, then it is our responsibility as members of the body of Christ to bear one another's burdens in that sense. If we have the capacity to, we might not have the capacity to, and in that case, then we should set them up with maybe help somebody else that could help them that's more mature or has the time or maybe had that situation or something similar happen in their lives where they could lean on them, you know? So, but that's a good question. You're supposed to always say that in conferences. Very good question. Next! No, just kidding. I learned that a long time ago, and I've never, I just make jokes about it. But anybody else?
Yeah, I have a question. How do you deal with situations whereby you have someone who wants to move from one church to the other,
mm-hmm.
and still maintain the integrity of the friendship?
So someone that wants to leave your church,
yeah, go to another church
and go to another same Greater Grace church or just another church in general?
Yeah,
I say, God bless you.
And,
usually.
And make sure the friendship still
it has happened to me many times. Usually we don't maintain fellowship. I had a wonderful family. I'm sure they got offended by someone, not me, in our church that left the church, didn't say anything, but I noticed they weren't there. I called them, they didn't answer. But then I got an email from the husband telling me all the reasons why they were no longer going to go to our church. I mean, essentially, they had moved about 3 or 4 miles further away. They had to drive 7 miles instead of 3 miles. But already we had moved, so that was why they had to drive 3 miles. They used to only have to drive 1 mile. And there were other things as well. And, you know, I hated to lose them. But what was I going to say? So I wrote them back a letter in the best possible way that I could. I said, I totally understand. Because we didn't maybe have all the resources for their kids at that time either. And I said, I understand. And I thank you for the time you were with us. I thank you for the sacrifices. I thank you for all that you did in helping us. You were a big part of our church, and I want to send you away with my blessing. And we have maintained I get a Christmas card from him once a year. So, and, you know, once in a while he likes something that I say on Facebook, you know, which I always appreciate a lot. If they came back, I would tell them that they owe me 3 years worth of tithes. That's what I would say. If they want to get their membership back. No, I mean, of course, yes. If they came back, they were not negative. They were not troublesome. They were wonderful. And of course, I would welcome them back. And someone that had been negative that came back, I would have a little chat with them. A big chat with them. Yeah. If someone left on bad terms, I would say the same thing. Thank you that you're making it easy for me by leaving. No, I wouldn't say that. I would bless them. I would say this. So this one woman called me recently, and her husband is in prison, and her son is in prison, and her daughter just got out of prison. And she, you know, hasn't been to church very much anyway. Her life is a mess. Her family is a mess. And it's all because of her own decisions and her family's decisions. They're a mess. They're just a mess. But God gives us messes, you know, to deal with. And I don't know that, I don't think I've been the best pastor to their family. I haven't. I tried a couple times to visit the husband in prison. It was very difficult to get in. I never tried to visit the daughter. She's in Florida. I never tried to visit the son in prison. He was in West Virginia. I didn't really respond to his letters because I'm an idiot. And, you know, I just, you know, I don't know why. I just don't have the ability or the grace to deal with them or the time. And I love them, though, and she would come, and actually her father comes. He loves our church. But it's a mess. And I only know them because of her sister who came to our church, and her family was a mess. It was unbelievable. But we still love them and friends with them. And she said she was going to go to another church, and I said, why? And she said, because we don't love them, and we judge them. And I said, I understand. I said, I don't see you. She said our message changed. And I'm not disputing the fact that I don't give them the time that another pastor could give them. I don't have the time. I don't have the time to go to the prisons, and I should learn how to do that. I honestly don't have the time. And I told her that, and I apologized. She said she was going to go to another church. She told me the name. I checked out the church. I said, I know that church. I've been to that church. I went to a conference at that church. Andy Stanley spoke there, and another guy, Greg, what's his face? The guy that has the Bible app in Oklahoma. No, the other guy. The one that everybody has on their iPhone, his church. But I said, listen, when you come back to the state, they have a Saturday night service. I'd be happy to go to the church with you, and I'll introduce you to the pastor. You know, and maybe this will be a good place when your husband gets out of prison. Nobody will know him, and you'll have a fresh start in a mega church, and you don't have to worry about it. You know, and she really appreciated that. And I would gladly do that, and I would bless her, and I would totally understand. And I do believe that our church is not the church for everybody, and it is, because it isn't, it really isn't. And I think they're probably more aware of it than I am sometimes. And I think it's probably the grace of God that some people that I wished had stayed did not stay, because maybe they are troublemakers, or maybe they just don't fit in, or maybe whatever. I don't know. God knows why. I always feel like if I was full-time, our church could be twice as big, but I don't know that. I don't know that. One of our churches one time, they thought that they were in a bad location. And so because they were in a bad location, they basically mortgaged everything that they had, and they got a building on a very busy street, had a big sign, and the church didn't grow. It shrunk. So go figure. We always think of the natural. We were in some rotten, stinky neighborhood. Remember, Rita? That nobody, the only reason I got into the Montgomery County schools to be able to rent a school was because nobody wanted this place. There was all one-way streets. Nobody could find it. That's why I had 1,000 signs. And even with the signs, people couldn't find it. I had way more signs back then, Justin. We had, because you had to have them on every corner. It was ridiculous. But people found us. Right, Rita? I mean, we had crowds in that place. And now, then we went to a big main street, Dennis Avenue. You got Georgia Avenue, massive, goes right to the White House. Then you got University, which goes right to the University. You know, it's huge. And Dennis cuts in between. And Rock Creek Park is right there. Big school, main road. We shrunk as soon as we went to that place. And it took years for us to, because people stopped coming, because they're lazy. Anyways, and they weren't saved anyways, so whatever. So God did it. God moved us. But we now, then we, it took us a while. That was a big transition, but we grew. And so you can be in some hole in the wall, and if God's got his hand on it, you know. And God had his hand on us, but God maybe caused us to shrink because he knew we needed to shrink. We needed to learn to suffer. We needed to learn how to really minister to people. And I still make so many mistakes. It's unbelievable. You know, that's crazy. Like the fact that I haven't visited that woman's, I tried twice, then I gave up. That's like shameful. I'm embarrassed. And I don't blame her. You know, it's hard. And she deserves better. You know, so we fail a lot of times. Now I'm whipping myself. In the back. And I do care. Sort of.
Don't you feel like God does that sometimes? Like, I feel like sometimes I just can't get to a teenager. I don't know why.
Yeah.
Like, everything I try falls apart. It's just not meant to be.
Yeah. Yeah, I never tried. I tried twice, and then I gave up. So I can't really use that excuse so much. Yeah. Nah. I don't think, I mean, for some reason, I've always had a hard time with prisons. I don't know why. Any other questions before we close? Nobody's going to come to my church anyway. That guy is terrible. He deserves everything he gets. Father, thank you for tonight and for this master's course. I pray that the rest of the classes would be so blessed, that you would really give great understanding, true discernment, wisdom, that you would impart life through these classes. I thank you for your love for each and every one of us. Thank you, and I pray that we would always, in everything that we do, lift up Christ, Lord, as the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit always deflects from itself and lifts up the Lord Jesus Christ, as should we. And so, Lord, I pray that you would be lifted up in our hearts today, this evening, that you would also protect us as we walk or drive or however we're getting home this evening. I pray that there would be, everybody would get home safely and be blessed in these things. It's only Monday. We got the rest of the week, Lord, of classes, and I pray that it would be awesome for each and every one. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, everybody.